Thank you very much for this kind introduction. I still don't know exactly why I was asked to speak here, and I have to ask Jim for that. I mean, I prescribe an awful lot of Metamucil. I guess that makes me partly part of your crowd, and I'm a gastroenterologist, so I'm probably one of the ones who gets most closest to the microbiome than most of you in my daily work. So possibly that are my credentials. So let's see what we make out of that. Now, I was very pleased to hear Lisa talking about how little we know what constitutes fibers and how difficult it really is to figure out how much is eaten on a daily basis and which parts of the foods actually are being part of the counting of fiber content and what does fall out. And then Andrew, when he talked about the different countries that he compared, that not everybody really knows what the other one is doing, and it's pretty hard to compare this. Now, thank you for the topic then to talk about fibers, because that goes into my talk as well. The other problem is obviously the microbiome. So the microbiome is something that we're still learning to know about. I think it's possibly still early stages to really say what the microbiome actually is or what it does for that matter. So again, we combined here two topics of which we don't know an awful lot, so that makes this talk quite interesting. Therefore, I added a little disclaimer in there and said a clinical viewpoint. So when it gets a little bit too hardcore for me, I'd branch out into what I know best, and that's clinical practice. Since I know I'm going to talk to a lot of people who know something about food, I thought I'd bring you a little menu. So there's an introduction here on the menu which talks about the microbiome as such. We will talk a little bit about the function of the microbiome. I'm a little bit of a burnt child when it comes to, for instance, the genome-wide association studies, where there was a lot of hoo-ha about these studies, and we thought, well, finally we cracked this clinical nut, and we just test everybody who comes through our clinical doors and get their genetics, and then we know what's wrong with them. Well, far from it, and I still think that we don't know much, and the genome is still not helping us. So I wonder whether with the microbiome we are a little bit in that stage still as well, that we try to explain all these things, but then how much does it really help us in our clinical practice? Probably very little. So I talk about the function of the microbiome, then how to manipulate the microbiome, because that's obviously ultimately what we want to do, and fiber in clinical practice. So, the microbiome, if we just take the microbiome as this thing that lives in us right in the middle in the GI tract or in the gastrointestinal tract, we know that every day almost studies come out that implement the microbiome in some sort of chronic disorder, be it adipositas or obesity, be it diabetes, mental health, any sort of cancers, and we heard that before from what Andrew said, fiber and cancer, so microbiome and cancer. This down here, I forgot what this logo is for, this icon, was that environment or something like that. Metabolism is being influenced by the microbiome, of course. Inflammation, the red flame over there, cardiovascular disease, irritable bowel syndrome. There is probably nothing that we don't find a study that would say, oh yes, the microbiome is involved in that. And I keep telling my wife, you know, I'm not overweight, it's my microbiome that is really causing this. And I need to manipulate my microbiome, I don't need to manipulate anything else. And that obviously spurred interest in microbiome transplantation or fecal microbial transplantation, FMT. There was a review not too long ago, 3 years ago, and if you write another review or read another review, this list has probably grown tremendously, and it talks about potential clinical indications. Now, on the top of those potential indications is Clostridium difficile infection. I think this is where the whole idea came from, and this is now accepted standard medical practice, at least after a couple of failed antibiotic treatment attempts. One would go towards an FMT to get rid of this Clostridium, and this is done in America quite often, and to a certain degree starting to have a foothold here in New Zealand as well. And this stands on very strong scientific feet. We have one randomized controlled trial that showed the success. So why don't we just go ahead and do it? Now, other things are in the pipeline, and there are more and more studies coming out that either dispute or indicate this kind of indication. We talk about inflammatory bowel disease. We talk about irritable bowel syndrome, obesity, diabetes, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, atopy, rheumatoid arthritis, autism, depression. As I said, the list is endless. And patients seem to be rigorously believing in FMT, the power of FMT. I got an email the other day where somebody said, well, if you don't do it, I take the microbiome of my healthy 12-year-old daughter and do it myself. Go for it, please, by all means. I don't mind if that's what you want to do. I think why clinicians are still a little bit hesitant, apart from a few shining lights in Australia and America that use FMT for all sorts of indications, why other clinicians are a little bit hesitant if the microbiome causes or has implications in the causation of all these chronic disorders. How do I know that I might treat one disorder but give the patient another disorder if I don't really know what I'm doing? So that's at least where my skepticism comes from. And how do I know if I treat diabetes with FMT? Well, the patient might be fine but might end up with inflammatory bowel disease. Now you can toss a coin, what's better for the patient? I don't want to be the clinician on the receiving end. There's a nice court action in America where a lady took the microbiome of her daughter and she had irritable bowel syndrome. Her daughter was healthy but a little bit obese. So now that patient has no IBS anymore, but she's obese. She's now suing her doctor for being obese because he didn't disclose that complication of the microbiome transplantation. So you wonder a little bit what's going on there. So that's probably where the hesitation comes to just take the whole lot and put it into another patient. There are studies going on and research going on to shrink the microbiome down to a few essential components to just transplant those. But for that, we would need to know what are these essential components. And I talked to Gerald Tannock a while ago and said, what are the essential components of the microbiome? And Gerald couldn't answer this question because there is probably not an easy answer to that question. We know how to manipulate the microbiome. At least we know what manipulates the microbiome. Quite a lot does manipulate the microbiome. So obviously, diet. Diet manipulates the microbiome a great deal. What we eat is what our bacteria eat, and then is what the composition of the microbiome is all about. Exercise, apparently so, manipulates the microbiome. We did a study quite recently where we used exercise to treat inflammatory bowel disease, and we looked at the microbiome, couldn't find anything, but then we just didn't have that many people looking at that. Genetics, our genome will obviously manipulate the microbiome. Everybody is a little bit different, both from their genetic fingerprint, and that leads through to the microbiome fingerprint. So genetics do it, the environment, drugs, what we're exposed to, how many medications we're taking. And I had a patient this morning who was convinced that the many courses of antibiotics she had in her childhood caused her symptoms that she's now seeing as a 37-year-old, which is most likely irritable bowel syndrome. And I couldn't dispute that. I couldn't say no, it has nothing to do with it, because I simply didn't know. The immune system is obviously a big player in our how our microbiome is being shaping up, and the location where we're living, the environment that we spend our time in. And I think there are some very nice studies about that. But as I pointed out before, research into the microbiome hasn't finished. This is a study that was just published this year in Nature Biotechnology, and these guys were able to discover 100 more new gut bacteria in the human microbiome. So I guess by the time this talk finishes, probably somebody has found some more gut bugs. The question is just, is it important if we find them? Do they do anything just by naming them and finding them? Does this really make a difference here? So if we drill it down to the diet is what influences, at least short and a bit long term, our microbiome, the composition of our microbiome the most. So let's look into the diet, and here the task was given to me to look at fiber. Now I had to look up what constitutes fiber, and again, Lisa, thank you for not telling us exactly what constitutes all that dietary fiber, because I think there's still a lot of dispute out there. But the articles that I read said, well, we're all falling back onto this Codex Alimentarius from 2009, which basically says edible carbohydrate polymers with three or more monomeric units that are resistant to the endogenous digestive enzymes and thus neither be hydrolyzed or absorbed in the small intestine. Recommended 25 to 38 grams per day. That's what this publication said that I was reading. So the important bit in here is that It is resistant to digestive enzymes, and it goes into the large intestine, so it doesn't get eaten up early on, goes into the large intestine, and therefore has the chance to directly interact with the microbiome. So, how does this interaction look like? Well, it looks like that. Apparently, we humans don't have enough enzymes to break down these fibers, so we get help from our intestinal bacteria, from our microbiome, to break down these fibers so they don't go to waste. And lots of these bacteria that we harbor in our intestines, they have lots of enzymes who can help us breaking down these fibers and can make them useful for us, can use them as fuel in whatever we talk about. So we talk here, we see here a couple of studies that just look into that. And the interesting bit here is, and I have one slide at the end that emphasizes that again, these bacteria, these individuals have very much carved out their niche. So they're not doing everything does the same. So every human being has a different makeup of their microbiome, and we have a different capability of breaking down these fibers. And I think that's an important point. So some of these gut bacteria are really just there for a certain niche, or just live in a certain niche and just wait for these fibers to come along to thrive on these fibers. What happens then? Well, the dietary fibers get broken down by these different bacteria. Fermentation happens into short-chain fatty acids, and then you have this magic word of development of the immune system. Well, what the heck is development of the immune system? Do we just have an immune system because we have fiber, or is there something else going on? Well, this study here looks at germ-free mice, so right at the beginning, I'm a bit hesitant to press a button that will bring it forward. What happens if I press this button? So this happens. Good. So this is SPF mice. So this is mice that live in a specific pathogen-free environment, and looked in this particular study here, they looked at FOXP3 exhibition and CD4 exhibition, and this gives you this kind of picture. But if you have germ-free mice, this picture looks much different. So frequency of this specially stained CD4 cell is about 15% here, whereas in germ-free mice, it's about 7% here. And if you add these short-chain fatty acids into the diet of these mice, they make more of these FOXP3 CD4 cells, FOXP3, into a mix to here at the end. Different short-chain fatty acids do different things on the immune system. So obviously, there is a link of the immune system with the fibers that we're eating, and it depends how much we're adding to this. Which leads me to some questions. This direct interaction, well, effect of fiber on the microbiome as a whole, or just on individual bacteria? And what is the clinical consequence of all that? There's a nice quote in this paper from 2018, all fibers induce specific shifts in microbiota composition, and which of these contribute to health benefits, or if they're even functional relevant, has not yet been established. So we still know very little of the whole thing. This study is a study from 2010 that compared, and I think that was shown before, that compared children that grew up in different parts of the world. And indeed, the exposure quite early in childhood shapes your microbiome, what this looks like. So this study here was comparing a plant-based Burkina Faso diet, so a diet of children that lived in Burkina Faso. Their fiber content per day, and I was surprised to see that, is still way below what's recommended in our country. Their fiber content was about 12.6 to 14.2 grams of fiber per day and reduced fat and animal protein, whereas this Western European Union diet here had a content of much less, 3.3 to 8.6 grams per fiber a day, and obviously more fat and more animal protein. And this is what came out of the whole thing here. So we have here, this is the Burkina Faso diet. We have a lot more of gut bacteria, a part of the Bacteroidetes family, and much less of the Firmicutes. You see the Firmicutes here up in red, whereas the absolutely opposite is true for the Western diet. So these kids here ended up with a lot of Firmicutes and much less Bacteroidetes. And the researchers in that paper went on to examine the short-chain fatty acid content that comes out of that to get an idea of, is it relevant? Who's living living in our gut. And yes, of course, it is very relevant. The total short-chain fatty acid content in these Burkina Faso kids was much higher compared to this is irritating, Lisa, I agree with you, was much higher than the fatty acid content in the European kits, and this was true for all three tested, for all four tested short-chain fatty acids. So there was a difference. But again, the next question was, what consequence had that? And I showed you earlier on a picture that obviously the short-chain fatty acids do influence the immune system. So did it have any consequence on fighting off bacteria, fighting off pathogens? And the answer is possibly so. You see here a higher content of E. coli in the gut of the European kids, more Salmonella, Shigella, and way more Klebsiella. So obviously, these potentially pathogenic bacteria were reduced by this diet that was introduced to these children early on. So I think that puts the link between fiber, microbiome, and immune system very nicely out there. But this is a long-term intervention. Of course, if you live as a child in these countries, this is the diet you're being fed from early on, and these kids were at the age of 1 to 6, so after weaning to 6 years of age, and that's the time when the microbiome is being shaped quite vigorously. But how about these short-term intervention diets, the diets that we hear a lot about? For instance, the low FODMAP diet in irritable bowel syndrome. This is a diet that reduces a lot of the fiber intake in those patients. Well, there is a change here. Whoops. Plant. Yeah. So this is the short-term change. We have a bit of a washout period of a couple of weeks or 4 weeks. Then we have 4 weeks on a plant-based diet, and then we have a washout again. And the same we do here with a washout, then an animal-based diet, and a washout again. So these first two panels here, they look into the fiber intake of these people, and the fiber intake obviously goes up tremendously, and the fat and the fiber intake in the animal-based diet goes down tremendously. Similar correlations with fat intake, protein intake, and certain other things. So if you look at the outcome of that, the short-chain fatty acids change as well within these 4 weeks of just being on this diet with a plant-based diet, giving you much more of the acetate short-chain fatty acid and a little bit more of butyrate. And the others as well. So the change is very rapid. So with a dietary intervention, we can cause a very rapid change in short-chain fatty acids. So this is what I meant to lead into, these dietary interventions that we're prescribing our patients, and that becomes more and more fashionable. So Staudacher Heidi, she did a study in 2012 on the effect of low FODMAPs in irritable bowel syndrome. She did find that bifidobacterium species went down dramatically in this diet, where she didn't find much change in some other bacteria. No change in pH, interestingly enough, because that's one of the postulated mechanisms, and no change in short-chain fatty acids. That was repeated by an Australian study, and they talk about the Australian diet versus the low FODMAP diet, whatever that means. Exclusive enteral nutrition is another diet that has been proposed as a therapeutic diet for inflammatory bowel disease, and it's quite hard to figure out what these people are talking about when they talk about a normalization of microbiota, because what is normal, and I think that's still a term that needs to be defined, but possibly it became closer to the healthy controls than what it was before, and there was a reduction in Fecalibacterium prausnitzii. This is a picture that I stole from Ruth Harvey's PhD thesis, and she had very low numbers. In fact, this is an N equals 1, and she put a IBS patient in comparison to a non-IBS patient, and she put them after a 10-day washout period on a low FODMAP diet, and again, what she was able to show was that within 2 or 3 days, the change was visible in the microbiome of these patients. So again, a very fast and very effective intervention if we then know what we want to change and if that then happens. If we don't, if we then take a step back and say, okay, we don't really want to have the whole diet changed, maybe we change a little bit of the diet, prebiotics come to mind. Prebiotics are dietary supplements that feed specific bacteria. Mainly the dietary supplements are the fiber supplements of inulin and the others. A study here on rats showed with inulin there was no change in bifidobacteria, but the amount of short-chain fatty acids went up, and with Arabonyxolian, some bacteria went up, the short-chain fatty acid production went up, and the cecal pH went down. So again, with prebiotics, there is a good chance to influence this microbiome. Yes, let's move on to, this is a summary of the whole thing, but you can look this up yourself when you get the slides. But let's move on to, so what? So what? What does that help us? Is that really helpful in clinical practice? And I'm coming from a field of inflammatory bowel disease, so every patient that we make a new diagnosis of says, what shall I eat from now on? Do I need to change my diet? And my standard answer is usually, no. You don't need to change your diet because I wouldn't know what you need to change. I wouldn't know what you need to cut out or not. You will find out yourself what you can tolerate and what you can't tolerate. Is this really true? And then when I have a young patient, mom and dad sitting there and said, told you so, you were eating too much McDonald's. Well, is too much McDonald's really causing inflammatory bowel disease? I'm not entirely sure if that's the case. So, this is a Nature Reviews from a very reputable researcher, Sue Ying from Hong Kong, and she put the year 2018 into review and what we're going to expect in the field of inflammatory bowel disease. And right here at the beginning, she says, diet. A high-protein diet, dietary psyllium, and food additives modify IBD risk in mouse models. Diet's influence on gut inflammation is likely the sum of multiple dietary components. So she says from 2018 onwards, we need to focus on diet. She thinks that very early after the diagnosis, dietary manipulation intervention should be attempted. Unfortunately, she did a one-pager, and she didn't tell us exactly what she meant by that. But the study she referred to is this study. So they used mice on a, again, specific pathogen-free or germ-free background, and they treated them with DSS. Now, DSS coming from the drinking water gives a mouse on a certain background colitis. It's a little bit like if you're drinking bleach, that gives you a certain inflammation. So that's how these mice feel like. And then they used a lot of different fibers and tried to, with a multiple regression analysis, try to figure out which was the fiber that causes harm and which was the fiber that did good. So they found out that psyllium, pectin, and cellulose fiber reduced the severity of colitis. Microbiome dependent, so it just worked in SBF mice and not in germ-free mice, whereas psyllium was both in germ-free and non-germ-free mice. So, is that enough of a message to focus on this research? Dietary protein increased the density of fecal microbiota and the severity of colitis, also just microbiome dependent. So, we need to focus on fiber because obviously fiber plays a role in the development of colitis. Does it really? Because this is a big study here, fiber intake and the development of inflammatory bowel disease, the European prospective multicenter cohort study, the EPIC study. Now, the EPIC study followed about 400,000 people between 1991 and 1998. They collected all the data of these people and then just waited for these people to develop inflammatory bowel disease. They waited, and after 8 years or so, they had 104 patients with Crohn's disease and 221 patients with ulcerative colitis. And they checked all their baseline fiber intakes and followed them up over time and said, well, there must be something in it. Well, not. There is nothing in it. The fiber intake on average of patients with Crohn's disease was 22.3 grams and the controls 21.9 and ulcerative colitis 22 and 21.9. So in that huge study, they couldn't find an effect of fiber. If you want to read the study, they go down in details and see whether there's a cutoff point somewhere, a little bit more fiber or the ones with an awful lot of fiber, but it doesn't come to any conclusion that fiber intake can really modify the development of inflammatory bowel disease in this study. But you just read another study and the picture looks different. So this study here, fiber intake reduces the risk of inflammatory bowel disease, result from a meta-analysis. So these guys set down what Andrew Reynolds does best. They looked at all these studies and they started with 1,300 studies and finished off with 8 studies that in their mind fulfilled the criteria of their search. And they said, well, yes, the risk of Crohn's disease was reduced by 13% for every 10 grams of increment in fiber intake. So a modest but nevertheless a result that is encouraging that maybe fiber does play a role in the whole thing. And then comes the question, and this is my second last slide, is fiber not only good to prevent inflammatory bowel disease, would fiber maybe be good for treatment and maintenance of already established inflammatory bowel disease? And these guys here did a review of randomized controlled trials. Well, in Crohn's disease, none of the 12 studies they looked at reported any benefit of fiber in treatment and maintenance of Crohn's disease. 3 studies in ulcerative colitis, 1 from 1 study in pouchitis, but they all agreed on fecal butyrate went up, and so all these secondary endpoints, fecal calprotectin, one of the inflammatory markers that we measure in the stool, went down, inflammatory cytokines went down, disease severity indexes went down, and there was a change to the microbiota composition. So maybe we just need to refine our treatment, and then we come to success. And this is then the butyrate story that was picked up many years ago. This is a study from 1992 where butyrate enemas were tried in patients. And yes, they have a modest effect on the endoscopic score as seen down here. So the endoscopy score went down in those patients and the histological grading went down. So obviously that was successful in left-sided ulcerative colitis. And this is a summary of all these studies that were done with butyrate, but there was a little bit of a sour note. Since butyrate acetate cannot be patented, it is of little interest to the pharmaceutical industry, except in regards to developing different types of release formulations. So that's probably one of the fallback points. If the industry is not interested, research lags behind and will not be much supported. So in summary, ladies and gentlemen, the intestinal microbiome is central to the development of different chronic disorders. I think we can be sure about that. The diet plays a significant role in the composition of the microbiome. The exact effect of dietary manipulation on the microbiome is yet unknown, and the exact effect of the microbiome in disease development is also unknown, but I think we can close this with the future is bright. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michael. And questions or comments?
So you mentioned short-chain fatty acids quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Would you consider increased short-chain fatty acids detected in feces to be unequivocally a good thing without regards to, for instance, short-chain fatty acids in serum levels or those that are absorbed as a primary energy source by colon enterocytes?
Well, the studies point towards the increased short-chain fatty acids in the fecal samples to be the more important ones than in the serum, so yes.
Michael, I just a comment. I wonder sometimes whether we're measuring the wrong things. Once again, a lot of these correlations are with total fiber, and as you've said, that's a moving feast. And maybe if you looked at fermentable fiber, which incorporates a physical attribute, we could get a different answer. And some recent work from Carlos Montoya in Palmerston North, his work has shown no correlation whatsoever between short-chain fatty acid concentrations and actual production rates. So if we look at concentrations in feces or an ileal digester, they are not correlated with the production of the short-chain fatty acids, and it's that total production we need to look at. So, you know, it's a, as you say, it's a developing field. And I think sometimes we have to step back and say, what are we measuring? What does it mean? You know, otherwise you'd always, this confusion.
I fully agree with you,
Okay, thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you.